able to sell the paper. So that means that you need to make some compromise and at least a level of accuracy. So lockup, we already mentioned this structural commitment. Structural commitment, what is this exactly? Is that some companies have historical shareholders. Let's say your company has IDinvest as a shareholder, BPI. So sometimes you go and see these people and say, I'm going to foresee for a listing in the next 12 months. Are you ready to commit to subscribe because I'm going to raise 10 million euros, 2 million each, for instance? So you already start the IPO process with some commitments of your historical shareholder to subscribe to the new increased capital of the IPO. So this is something which is very comfortable. Very comfortable. For instance, we as an investment banker will do this job for you and with you to be sure that when we need to raise, let's say, 10 million euros, if we can secure 4 million euros with the historical shareholder, it makes life much easier. Why not? And then choosing the market, so that is quite simple, it depends on the industry and the size and the timing, that's what we mentioned in the beginning. So what are different steps to go to an IPO? So first of all, we need to prepare the prospectus, so it's a document of, let's say, 300 pages with chapter 6, where you put everything in detail, and where you will describe the supervision of the IPO, the timing, or it will include also all the legal aspects related to the company and the financial statements. Second step is the equity story. So please prepare your business plan for the next 2 years. This business plan, once it's finalized, will be used for evaluation. Finalize your equity story, and please agree among all the management teams so that you all agree on the same story. The research report will be done by the investment bank. The research report is a document around 25 pages with a market analysis, then the position of the how the company is positioned, and it will finish with evaluation of the company. Is done by the research analyst who is specialized in the sector. And then we start what we call the marketing. So we start with the pilot fishing, that means we have the research report ready, the PowerPoint, the equity deck ready, and we meet investors, so the CEO is trained as well for hours, so that the speech is very clear. And for 1 hour, we will do the speech in front of investors. And we will see how people react. So we will select 3 to 5 investors that we know very well, the specialists in the sector, and they will say, I'm ready to invest, or I'm not ready to invest, but or this valuation is too high, or the equity story is not so credible, or the pipeline is too large. So they will give some feedbacks, and then maybe we'll change the valuation, or say it's too early, or react. So this pilot fishing moment is very important for in the IPO process. So marketing material will be ready. So marketing material is a summary of the preparation, the research report, the equity deck, the management training. So this is most against the communication agency. It's doing that with the CEO, with the founders and the management, to prepare for the investor questions and the investor presentation. Then we do workshops, as Fabien mentioned, so 8 meetings per day. So we need to prepare this. And then to be finalized the operation. Last but not least, that is the last step, is the visa on all the documentation. So they will check the prospectus, all the information given to the investors, all the information also given to retail investors on the website and so on. And all this needs to be really aligned. If they see that, let's say, for the retail investors, we have a lot of pitch, they will not accept it. It needs to be completely aligned. And all the information given to any investors needs to be inside the prospectus. If you say something that is not in the prospectus, they will ask you to add it and they will not give the visa. So, and then we do the final roadshows. We have all the subscription documents of all investors. After 1 hour meeting, they will say, I take 3 million euros, 5 million euros, half a million. And then we collect all this. And we have the IPO results. And then we have also the your next meeting in retail results. And then start the aftermarket. So once you're there, you're the new beginner of the IPO market. So it's a new life for you, it's not so easy, and you need really to deal with other subjects you're not used to deal with. It's first of all some Again, we need to keep on doing some modules. We need to ensure we keep the coverage of all the important research analysts. And we need to keep some liquidity, so give some news flow. So when we say news flow, that means that you need to stay top of the mind. You need to have some information about the commercial side, your new contracts with signed with clients, or new business opportunities, real ones, not fake ones, but real ones. And then on financials, every quarter you need to give your revenues and profits. So post-IPO note, you need to have this kind of research reports that are given to institutional investors. And have a liquidity contract means that you give a number of amount of shares to a security firm that is going to be counterparted on the market to ensure liquidity. You need to keep on meeting some analysts to discuss with them your perspective. And then we need also to give some input, also content to some small and medium-sized website stock sites like Boursorama, Boursier.com, and all these kind of websites. So you also need to go on with one-to-one with investors, roadshows, and that say investment as an investor bank, we also organize breakfast lunches with investors and workshops and seminars. So, what are the red flags, in fact, that you need to keep in mind when you prepare your IPO? I think what is very important on the accounting side, you need to be sure that you're very transparent. That means that you need to include in all the balance sheet the intangible assets, or that you value them. You keep all, let's say, some companies come and see us, they put their brand in a special kind of holding. This is something to avoid. Or they put IP in another holding and inside the listing scope. This kind of stuff, you need to be transparent, even explain your failure, we don't care. You need to be transparent and explain different steps of your history. You need to be very transparent, open-minded. If they feel you're hiding something, that's the end of the story. So, transparency is key. So maybe just as a closing, some takeaways for the closing. Just keep in mind that you need to do these preparations really like you're going for one IPO post and it's a real level. So you need to be very fit and you need to keep being very performant. It's a long process, around 6 to 9 months. It's finally finishing with some roadshows, with 8 meetings a day. So really you need to keep the pace and be prepared to go through the whole process. So preparation is really key. So that means that you have a team around you. You have chosen the best expert also when you go for this kind of process. Transparency, I already mentioned it, that is very important. Timing as well. So we mentioned this in the beginning. And choose the best expert as well to accompany you in this kind of process. So maybe if you have any questions.
Yes, thank you. As you can see, it's quite a laundry list of things to prepare and so in the preparation. Any questions from you about the IPO? Who's thinking about an IPO? Not yet.
Not yet.
Who might be, in a few years considering an IPO? Okay. So what do you think? Is that exciting prospects? Sounds like you want?
The liquidity sounds exciting.
Liquidity sounds exciting.
The rest of the country.
It sounds like you can't really sell that many shares as a founder initially, but it gives you a lot of power to drive the company, because now cash, your stock is also currency. So how liquid can you become as a
That's a good question. It depends maybe what's the portion you get. If you have 60% majority or minority, it depends. But I think as a founder it's difficult because it will give bad sign to the market. Even when a shareholder, a founder is selling, it's already a strange sign. Or it needs, again, transparency, so need explanation. But as I mentioned, maximum 1 million euros.
Many times shareholders sell a block of stock.
Yeah.
And that was what Fabian was checking in his phone. Like, okay, so there was a blog sale, I'm checking the act.
Yeah.
So that's
it's quite stressful.
Yes.
Can you cap the maximum number of shares for your portfolio?
What do you mean? The number of shares they sell?
Yeah, no, the time. Can you cap the number of one shareholders allowed to buy? When they go on the floor, that's really. Okay. In fact, if you have some threshold that you need to get to any level, so that means that when you go beyond and you buy 1%, 2%, it's not going to be declared to any level.
To some extent, once you're public, it's allowed to go and buy as many shares as possible. Some people can take control of companies as well.
But if you go 1% threshold, 2%, you need to declare it to be.
So it will be visible if someone is doing it.
And even if
but you can't block them.
No,
it's public.
Thank you very much. How are you to deal with it before the IPO?
You went to a crowdfunding?
No, it's just that.
And what's the percentage? Is it like
a
minority stake? 20%?
It's a minority. They have 50%.
50%?
0. 1.5. 1.5, 50%.
And they want to exit or not really?
Not sure.
Okay, that is not a problem. For instance, a family office can be shareholder with 50% of the shares. That is not a problem. So it's just to see which kind of shareholder agreement you have with them. It's not a problem for me. It's like a business angel. Maybe sometimes it's also holding because it's like a city or a province. So it's not a problem. Let's say if they have 50%, the founder has 85%, it's not a problem.
But they've already mentioned the IPO document anyway, just for one line.
And it's possible as a shareholder, again, in the EMF documents or in the prospectus, they will let you write who is the ultimate shareholder. So that means it's a holding, of course, but they want to know who is the IPO. So this will be the usual answer.
Any other questions?
Thank you very much. I had a question. You mentioned earlier that when there's a corporate VC already in the capital before the IPO, it might be a good sign for future exit, if I understand correctly. And I wondered if you could expand a little bit on this, because from some point of view, the IPO itself is the exit.
So, in fact, we say that IPO is an exit, but it's a partial exit only because you sort of refloat it to 20%, 25%. So, in fact, IPO is not an exit in itself, it's just it's a partial exit only. And then for the corporate VC fund, what I mentioned, in fact, it is an option for, because corporate VC, they were less small. Of course, I mentioned that they want to be minority kind of investments, but most of the case, and that's what the case of all of them, they were explaining that they were thinking about post-merger integration and so on. So their goal is maybe to have minority stake, but the goal is majority stake. When they maybe start as minority, but in their mind, in their language, company is majority. And then it's maybe 40 or 50% of the cases. So that is something to keep in mind. So that means that it will be one option for the exit. And once you have one option for the exit, it's a good start. To create a competition with other potential corporates that could be interested. So you already have one potential exit, which is most likely to be executed.
Is there a strategy if you, as a shareholder, you go IPO, you want to buy the company back, like Microsoft?
Like an RTO, you mentioned? Or?
You make IPO, let's say temporary for a few years. And you want to try to buy the company back to make it private again.
Okay.
So what do you have to do? You have to be too much successful or not enough?
Yeah. It's what you call a public to private, in fact. So in fact, you have some companies that are listed, and then after 5, 6, 7 years, they understand in fact that they have no advantage of being listed. So because reflect their potential. They, you know, they are informed by the process, a lot of post-IPO constraints. So they decide to leave the stock exchange. So this is a perfectly private process. Most of the case, what happens is that you don't know directly the CEO of the company, except if you have a large financial surface. You choose a private equity fund you're used to work with, and then you decide to do the public to private process with a PE fund. Okay. It's always interesting, to take the company private.
Actually, kind of interesting to cover the goal, but in a lot of Chinese companies went public in the US, and then when they realized that they could actually grow faster, I mean, there was a fast track to public in China, the multiples of the stock exchange in China were a lot higher. Mm-hmm. Now there's a lot of Chinese companies going private again to relist in China, so doing some kind of a market arbitrage, because the multiples could be like 15, 20 in the US, 50 or 100 in China. So once you're probably there, you get a lot more money, and then you can start to buy internationally, and the more you buy, the more higher your stock goes. So that's why it also makes it easier for them to make decisions, because they get multiple leverage next to the crazy Chinese companies. And you went to China for a while, so you've seen.
Yeah, exactly. And in fact, I saw from the same Europe, in fact, some Euronext companies that were undervalued on stock exchange, some PE funds decided to buy them, to put them out of the market, and then sell them again, because PE multiples were higher.
Interesting. Okay, so yeah, that's something we haven't really talked about today, about private equity, but that's one also of the big avenues for exits for companies. It's not just corporate, so it's not just with public. So that would be
a topic. Yeah, it's selling to private too.
Okay, maybe one final question if anybody has one. Otherwise, yes, last chance. No, then we'll wrap up. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, we will take a 5 minutes break, and then we have that one will be your final panel with VCs. And since